To tell us about their organization's work on combating human trafficking today, I'm joined by Jennifer Reyes Lay, the Executive Director of the U.S. Catholic Sisters Against Human Trafficking, and Hilary Chester, Associate Director of the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops Anti-Trafficking Program. Jennifer, you work with U.S. Catholic Sisters Against Human Trafficking to combat modern-day slavery. How do you approach this important work?
Yes, thank you so much, and thank you for highlighting this incredibly important issue on your show today. We see this as a multidimensional issue, and so we try and approach it from various forms. One is certainly education and prevention, as you mentioned, getting the word out, educating people on what are the signs to look out for. How can they recognize potential cases of human trafficking? But even before that, we want to make sure that people don't become victims of trafficking themselves. And so we do a lot of education, both with children and teachers, church members, you know, healthcare workers, anyone who's willing to learn about this issue to help prevent human trafficking, to know what makes people vulnerable in order to help prevent it. We also engage advocacy work in order to address the laws that are in place to make sure that victims are protected and have the resources that they need and don't become vulnerable in the first place. And then finally, we provide those direct services to survivors, making sure that they have shelter, they have resources for counseling and healing, they can get their education and pursue their goals after they're able to escape from their trafficking situation.
Hilary, the USCCB's anti-trafficking program has a similar three-pronged approach, but you have a heavy focus on immigrant communities. Can you tell us why?
Sure. And thank you for inviting me to speak today on World, sort of the Global Day of Awareness and Prevention of Trafficking in Persons. It's very timely. Our organization, the Bishops Conference, engaged in this work as far back as the late 1990s. And at that time, everyone's concept what human trafficking was that kind of foreign national victim, someone being lured out of their country into a second country where they were exploited. And so we housed the programming within our Migration and Refugee Services unit because we were serving foreign national victims who were here in the U.S., had been exploited here in the U.S. Over the years, as the paradigm shift and the concept of what constitutes trafficking, what are the all various forms of human trafficking, have evolved to recognize that U.S. citizens, particularly children, can be victims and survivors of human trafficking. There were a lot of organizations over the years that have come on board and have the focus on the U.S. citizen, child commercial sexual exploitation victims. And so we thought it would be good for us just to stay more focused on that initial population of the foreign national, where we have a deep institutional knowledge, expertise, and programming that complements our trafficking programs with unaccompanied migrant children, refugees, asylum seekers, migrants coming out of detention who are vulnerable to being exploited. So we've stayed focused on that, not exclusively. We do advocacy, awareness raising, around all forms of human trafficking.
And Jennifer, who's most at risk here? We're talking about migrants and how the trafficking situation has changed. Who is most at risk of human trafficking in the United States?
Yeah, that's a great question. And it's really a diverse population. There's no sort of single face of most at risk human trafficking. What traffickers do is they prey upon vulnerabilities. And so people who are unemployed are more vulnerable, people who are living in situations of poverty, youth who are homeless or runaways are incredibly vulnerable because they don't have that support system. They're easier to take advantage of. You know, really anyone who's kind of isolated or looking for someone that they can trust, that they can rely on, traffickers know that. And they swoop in there to build that trust to then take advantage of those vulnerable populations.
And runaway teens, is there anything else that you could say that parents would want to know about how to avoid this issue for them?
Absolutely. As I believe it was mentioned, you know, during the pandemic, one of the things that we've seen is an increase in traffickers approaching youth online, you know, through the apps, through social media. It's incredibly important that parents are aware of what their children are doing on their phones or their electronic devices, what kind of apps they have access to, who they're talking to, and then to notice any changes in behavior, too. That's one of the big red flags. If your child, you know, all of a sudden starts becoming more withdrawn, you know, is sneaking out or isn't where they say they are, Those shifts in behavior can be a real indicator that something else is going on. Really staying connected, maintaining that, you know, relationship of trust and open communication with your children, knowing who they're talking to, who they're hanging out with, what they're engaging in online is all incredibly important these days.
Hilary, you talked to us about this multifaceted aspect of human trafficking. It's not the way it used to be. Tell us about trafficking at sea. Who are the victims and industries that profit?
Sure. This is an area that we're especially interested in, and we've been partnering with some of the other ministries in the Catholic Church, the Apostleship of the Sea, or Stella Maris, which are the port chaplains located all around the world, have turned out to be amazing first responders and people that are right on the front lines of combating trafficking, because there's a lot of exploitation that happens in the maritime industry, and whether that's small-scale fishing fleets throughout Southeast Asia, where people can be lured into work situations that they think are going to be legitimate, and then once that boat is out at sea or that ship is out at sea and they're not coming back into port, they're incredibly vulnerable to just flat out not being paid, a lot of physical violence to keep people working, keep people compliant. But we also hear about cases where individuals are working in more legitimate work, but they may have paid for their position, so they used a labor broker. So they go into their job, which could be a legitimate job, but with tremendous debt. And then that labor broker is taking their wages, funneling off their kind of cut, and then passing on much lower wages than even the person had really contracted with that legitimate employer. And that's actually really common in a lot of industries that use migrant workers, foreign workers, but certainly the maritime industry, where people are out at sea, have a lot less contact with authorities, a lot less contact with their family, and just very limited ways of reaching out for help. There's a lot of exploitation. And then, again, sort of the wonderfulness about the Catholic Church is that we're present, and we are one of the few organizations, the few people that some of these folks have contact with when they come into foreign ports and aren't allowed to leave the port area because of immigration and visa issues, and they may only be in port for a few hours while their ship's unloading. And those port chaplains can talk to them and hear about what might be going on and raise the alarm.
Right, that's right. Jennifer, I've got two quick questions for you before we wrap up. One, it's impossible to have this conversation without talking about the victims. And how is helping them a part of Catholic social teaching?
Oh, absolutely. You know, fundamental to Catholic social teaching is the dignity of every person and entering into the joys and sorrows of one another's lives. And so direct services and support with survivors goes hand in hand with Catholic social teaching that tells us we are there to uplift the dignity of these people who've experienced this horrific crime, them with the resources they need to heal and to thrive, and that we have an obligation to engage in this work as a core component of our faith.
Hilary, I'm so grateful to you for everything that your organization is doing. Do you want to expand on that issue of Catholic social teaching?
I think it's just there's so many areas where trafficking touches on Catholic teaching, and we've had a program for several years now providing job readiness and employment services for survivors of trafficking so they can move into legitimate and dignified work. It's called Dignity of Work. And just, you know, people should feel fulfilled by their work. People should be able to have a living wage and support a family through their work. And that's another core area of Catholic teaching. And I think we don't always think about all the different aspects of Catholic teaching that touch on human trafficking and that inform our work and how we should respond as people of faith.
Well, this is a complicated issue, but a very important one. Thank you both for your work combating modern day slavery.
Thanks for having me.
For having us.